I didn't really say that family should have decent people, but I don't think I'm very decent. So, okay, my daughter is Kenneth Reese Ride Against Us. Or actually, it's my journey in the writing CSS in JS. So, sure, can anyone who's actually writing day to day CSS in JS already? Quite a lot. I guess about like 10. So, we share first. So, I have this friend. I think in April she was at this conference. It was like a tech conference, and then this person came up, and then like her first speech was about like how to start weird and not lose friends. Then once she said, oh, my way of doing it is CSS and JS, and then half the room left. Yeah, so I hope that not half the room.
I'll block the door.
Okay, this is my Twitter handle. If you're interested in dad jokes, I retweet a lot of dad jokes. Okay, background of what I'm doing, this is from my first job. So, I realized that all CSS in JS talk was beginning with, it's not that I don't like CSS. The thing is, I like CSS and, like, my first job was in an advertising agency, so I did a lot of CSS work. And then, it's not that I don't like CSS, I really like it a lot, but I realized that we can do something else. Okay, so I think a lot of us went through this whole process when we were doing CSS styling. So all the way from the start, we started inline style before we had .css file. And then we went to CSS, we looked at CSS Zen Garden, who taught us this new enlightened way of writing CSS that cascades. And then after that, we went to preprocessor. So we use SAS, we use LESS. And then we also move on to more of like structure, the OCSS, SMACSS, and I think a lot of it is that we wanted to try to manage CSS at scale. And I think this is one of the talks that was pointed out a lot when we talk about scaling CSS. This is his Twitter handle is the VJEUX. Christopher. So he works at Facebook, and then he shared this special in 2014 talking about how it's actually very difficult to use CSS at a scale. So he pointed out some of the problems. One is that CSS is always a global namespace. Like even if you use include, like you hand another file in, it's actually added in as on a global scale. So you run into like weird problems where file A requires file B, so it loads file B, and then file C also requires file B, but then it didn't load file B, but somehow it still works because A already loaded before. And then one day when you decide to pick up A, you realize that C doesn't load anymore because it depends on A, but it's not loaded. So when we're looking on JavaScript, we are very clear whether something is included, but then the CSS is a bit weird. And then, I think the most tough is the bit code elimination. Like when you want to remove CSS, like each refactoring is very painful. Like, at first there was this component that was being, maybe it's called button. And then after a while, this button is not used. It was removed from all your DOM. But then you are not that comfortable removing that inside CSS. Because you have to like grab through everything and then you see, hey, is this used before? Is it used in another class? So you feel a lot of pain when you're trying to like clean up your code, you're trying to refactor CSS. So yeah, this is the one that I think a lot of us end up doing, which is VEM. It uses the syntax of block element modifier.
Yeah, all the talks today have used Wattpad. It's a song you played earlier.
No, my specs were in cook there, okay, guys. What is this cook thing? Did you make me? You didn't use cook pen?
No, I don't do that one.
Just pretend we did it.
If anyone can find it, I'll ask you.
Okay, so this is how you write using VM. So there's a, let's say this base block is a button class, and then any form of modifier you actually append it behind with a double dash to mean that it's a modifier. So this is a normal button, and then this is a depressed button which actually takes in a class of button and also button depressed, which tries to modify some of the color from it, and then you'll get a modified version. So when you're working with VM, you are actually working in conjunction. So there's nothing that you can stop someone from using it badly, or like the person has like crazy naming ways, like it's a button, but the person loves ice creams, and then just call it dot ice creams, and then there's nothing to stop you, and there's nothing for someone to stop using VM also inside a project. So let's say if someone comes to the, into your project and then doesn't follow VM, where you'll be like, you, this is not the way to do it. So, at work, we have to deal with CSS on scale, so we work with VM a lot. And then that's when I started realizing that my code is very verbose and it's very, very long. So I started looking at atomic CSS, which is slightly controversial, because when you write with atomic CSS, it looks like this. Yeah, so you have like 1,000 plus each element. Each of them represent one thing actually. So like BA I think is border of, BW is border with. So if you change it to like 2, you can have So this is padding in the horizontal side and this is padding in the vertical side. So for this you realize one thing, your CSS file is super small because there's no rewrite. Like border with one is just gonna appear one type in your CSS file. You don't have a super small CSS file, but then your DOM becomes very hard to read. And then I realized like, so I actually use this style to do two projects that are in production. You might be even using it day to day, like it's a phone brand that I was looking. So, yeah, even the production was okay. File size was much smaller. There was almost no dead CSS code because there's nothing that you're running as custom. And then at the peak of working on a project, I was working super fast because I remember like padding horizontal is PH and then what's the tempo? 1, 2, 3, 4. But then if I stop looking at the code for a while and come back again, I realize I need to keep looking at the documentation. Of course, there are people who try to circumvent it. There are actually people who really, really like this library, and then they provide this for you. So just have a look at padding, and then you can see what does each link. But this is still a lot of reference to the documentation. Okay, so I think my favorite comment about this way of writing is, this is just a nice style. Like, you are just writing Eli styling in another way, using class, so that you don't feel so defeat. So, following that project, I had to work on another project, it's a coding brand, which is that I have to do the project in Angular 2. So, I know nothing about Angular 2 style encapsulation. I went into the project, and then I just anyhow write a style, and then I realized, oh my god, the style is stuck within my component. It's like, oh, nothing is going to override each other anymore. Like, Because what they do is that with each component, there is a hash of your CSS style, and then it appends a class to itself. I don't know whether this makes sense, but it's very close to what actually CSS body is trying to do. But then theirs is just without the word, it's just X, Y, Z, Z, 1, 2, 3. So following that, I was following a lot on CSS module because I realized that it solves a lot of problem of what BEM was trying to do. So BEM goes by convention, but CSS module forced you to write things that are locally scoped. You no longer write any CSS that is globally scoped. You can do that, but then by default, everything is locally. So that's when I move on to my next project, which is based on React. And then, as any lazy person who works with React, you use create React app because it sets so many things to default without you thinking about it. So, what is this? Yeah. So I was like, I'm gonna use create React app. And then I went in, I looked at the documentation, and it was this. We are not supporting CSS module. I was like, what do I do now? You just took away everything that I thought was the best way of doing things. I was like, okay, I'm gonna ask Facebook what's the best way of doing things, since you know Facebook people should be quite smart. So I went in and then I checked out, like, okay, React documentation, how do you do stuff? And then they say you should just set it in line. So this actually sets the documents, it actually writes in the dot style dot font size dot style dot something. So this is literally inline style. So I think a good question is, why do we not write inline style? I think a lot of times we'll say, okay, we don't write inline styles, but then why? Why do we not write inline styles?
No, it's reusable.
It's not reusable.
You can't overwrite them.
Yeah, you can't overwrite them. You can't use sudo. Any form of sudo over, before, after cannot be used. You can't write any media query. So you have no media queries, can you write inline? And if somebody writes important inline, okay, so I look at what create React app gives me. So, and then I realized that what they are doing is they have import app.css. I was like, this looks strangely close to the Angular one. Is it encapsulated? Is it locally scoped? And then I realized, no, it's just a webpack import. So at the end of the day, it just all import into one. So I back to square one. And then, I think a lot of us are very angry about using CSS and JS because we want to do unobtrusive JavaScript. So when we think about writing style with CSS, the first thing we think of is something like this. Like, okay, this title changes the size based on the screen size. And then over here, I just add event listener or resize the h1 using it in line. And if you look at the DOM, it's super ugly. So when we think about CSS and JS, this is what we think about. We're like, this is very ugly thing that we actually put it straight into our style. Let me try not to do that. So, I think it needs to come with an open mind. Okay, so I think I continue my journey into trying to still use CSS with React. And this is still the same two button, normal button and defense button. And then I still want to use CSS because I want to move away from it. And then I realized that, let's say if I just have one single component to this button, and then I want to modify it, let's say I'll pass it a prop that will say depress, I actually have to write something like this right inside my JSX to say depress. say that if there's a depressed, you need to put this class name. Slightly ugly, I feel like, okay, it works, but not beautiful. So that's when I was like, okay, it's time to look at CSS and JS. So there is a this list. So the first thing when you search for CSS and JS, you will come to this list, and then you'll be like, okay, let me try one line. So many, and this is the exact way of killing a developer. You just have to show them two things that are very similar, but then need to be changed, and then they will think about it, and then they will eat, and then they will stay in the room forever, and they will die. Okay, so, before I go on to what's the ultimate choice that I picked on, I found this, which is pretty interesting. It's cute. Okay, so this was a little bit like the Atomic CSS. It generates one line as one class. So color red is class A, display is class B. It's a bit less painful. So if you are still going to this path, you want to generate really, really small CSS file, but then you do not want to be referencing like documentation and then you want to write your own one, you can actually use this library. So over here we have this. Yeah, so each bit becomes an OPQRS and one bit represents one line. So it's almost like just now the Atomic CSS, but then this is something that you generate yourself. I think it's a good idea. I guess with this you have really, really small CSS file. Yeah, but it's the debugging is painful and probably nobody can debug with it. Okay. Okay, so the last library that I actually chose was Start Components. And I think this is a library that has been talked about over and over again, because one thing that really differentiates it is you are not writing JavaScript, but instead you are writing CSS straight here. So if you use any form of like syntax highlighting, it will actually highlight it properly for you. When you see over here, what it does is, instead of writing the class name, what you do is actually, you say it's a start button. So button will be your element. And then you name it as, let's say, any name you like. I'll name it start button over here. And then I replace my element with start button. And it will become a button with all this starting in. And if you check what's here, it's actually a button. It generates one class, and this class holds everything here. So what is this? This is actually a hash of all of this here. So if you have the exact same thing written, you will actually generate the exact same class. So I think for this, there is a lot of excitement, because you are writing real CSS, which comes with, you have pseudo element, you have media queries, and the V2 of start element, there is server-side rendering, which means that you can start writing crypto CSS using the library. Yeah, there is teaming, so you can actually write teams, and then you can pass this team all the way down to all the way to your nested component, you can still receive. Like, let's say that this team has a pink color as the base color, and every element in your project can receive this color. And a new interesting addition is also attributes. It's sort of like an escape hatch for a star element where you can actually set attribute strip. So let's say it really is let's say if you are using another library, let's say you're using Bootstrap, and you're not using VM Bootstrap, you're using the base, normal Bootstrap, you just include the CSS file. So you need to add in all the class name into your element. So instead of adding, let's say here, so instead of saying, let's say class name, this is a column 6. What the new style component allows you to do is actually to write it over here. Let's see, do I? Yeah, over here. So this, it can be like this. Fascinating. So it becomes like slightly optional. You can be totally using start component, and you can actually start to add things that you need. Okay, so I think there are some perks that comes with it that is not so direct, which is, I think, one thing that I really enjoy is there's no more build process. Of course, I'll talk about it later, but yeah, there's no build process. I don't need to set up like GUP or Webpack. Although React has Webpack, but it means that I don't need to think about this. I don't write mixing anymore. So, I mean, mixing is great, but there is context switching when I move between JavaScript and writing mixing, and this will mean that I only writing in JavaScript. It fits really, really well if you have if your workflow includes writing style libraries like, this is a button you should use across all the pages, and this actually works very well in this workflow, and there's almost no dead code. If you remove one component, all the style goes away with it. But I think there are some discussions. One is performance, because you are going to pass the JavaScript string, because it's still a string, you need to pass it, and then you need to pass it as a CSS. So there are people who are asking, is it something like, does it affect performance? Still arguable, like, okay. Debugging is slightly harder because you now look at the class, and the class is a hash, and you can't directly like point towards like what is causing the bug. So, but the biggest problem with using start component is rapidly changing style. Okay, so over here we have this. It's a panel that move in, move out, move in, move out. How this is calculated that is that it. It says a state, and then it actually tries to change the. I think the position of it. So, and you realize that the class name is changing. The problem is because, like what we were talking about just now, this is a hash of everything here. And if something changes, this whole class name changes. And yeah. I think that for now, the solution that has been discussed is to not use start component for that. And then the thing is, the ultimate like suggestion is do it like stuff. Yeah. So yeah, I think what I really like about start component is that this whole notion of like falling to success, like you don't have to follow convention because conventions are a big thing. And in order for something to work, you must be writing like the best form of the code. And yeah, this is huge. Okay. Thank you. Oh.
So what happens if, let's say, you are writing CSS for a button, right? And then you also have the button, somebody else also on React, so you might be like just adding HTML, CSS, somewhere else in your app, but your React one is, installing in React, so isn't it possible to write
it? It has to be Gisele. It's like a workaround. So just like the attribute where you can actually put in classing, you can actually reference another file. Okay. So you try to import that file and then you reference that class.
So there's no way for you to write something in the start component and you would use that outside the memory
directly? It's still a string. So if you can export that string and import it somewhere else, you can use it. But then if you try to use props inside that string, then you know. Somewhere else,
is there a way for it to fall back or like, maybe like if the proc's not there, then maybe just.
It's
a condition,
You can
for more props, then you'll fall back.
Because
it's just a number.
And then maybe you set the
number. Oh, okay. So that's just what we call.
It's going to shoot.
Whatever that matches the data stream. And if nothing returns, then just hold on.
So actually the style state compiled when the JavaScript runs. Is that right?
Okay. Where it's actually inserted in the head when it passes the JavaScript.
Really, what if client side JavaScript somehow fail?
CSS in essence.
Yeah.
So how's the file size or the byte size of your CSS compared to if you're using any other method?
The good thing is it's always loading what your current component requires, so you're never loading your whole CSS at any one time. So if you have many components, then only loading the same for that component might be even faster, even smaller faster.
But you're in SPO, so you're still sending all the code to the client anyway, so you are still sending it. I'm just curious, because normally when you have your CSS, you have one monolithic CSS file that has everything in there.
Yeah.
I'm curious if that's significantly different in file size and if it's compiled.
Unless you load your JavaScript columns, purchasing time, so if you need a component, maybe you need the app and you need it to load all of your...
Even aside from that, because I'm using React, and I'm not using inline CSS or anything along those lines, I'm just doing more traditional sets. So using React doesn't mean you have to do it that particular way. I'm curious to know if there's a difference in the actual size of the CSS. You have to do some tests.
Unless your CSS is really like 20,000 lines, it's like you really the difference. Really build a project, because I know she did projects from 30,000 lines. I did for it, but a lot of the a bit more responsibility. The difference is usually a couple hundred lines, and at the end of the day, the byte size. It's really not as significant. If you're optimizing down to byte, unless you really solve all the bigger problems. sometimes, like, I don't know, images. Yeah, it's a, to me, that's a bit micro-optimization. But I mean, as I said, then sometimes you'll tilt, like, square of it, then I'm like, oh, 30,000 lines, then I'll go. I used to wear everybody, so, so, yeah.
I wasn't thinking about how it usually comes from, like, use the word.
Yeah,
there's a framework that comes with a lot of puzzles. Yes! And then there's another framework that you don't
have to
copy as
another framework. Yeah. I think there's a bigger problem in React when people just add that small React libraries rather than adding CSS, because usually you can write CSS. Anyway.
Any other questions from the audience? Okay, if you're shy, okay, go and like secretly
chat. You just don't get chocolate.
Yeah, next video, and we're going to talk about...